We now move into our next keynote address by Mr. Danna Kammersgard, Executive Vice President, Cloud Systems, Seagate Technology. He'll be talking to us on the topic, the advancement of storage system designs for digital India. A brief introduction. Mr. Danna Kammersgard serves as Executive Vice President of Seagate, a global leader in data storage solutions. Prior to Seagate, Mr. Kammersgard served as the President of Dot Hill Systems Corp, and later as its Chief Executive Officer. Mr. Kammersgard served as the Chief Technical Officer of Dot Hill Systems Corp. He served as Secretary and the Senior Vice President, Engineering at Articon Inc. He served in various positions at Articon California in engineering and customer support, and prior to co-founding Articon California, Mr. Kammersgard served as Director and Software Development at Calma, a division of General Electric Company. Ladies and gentlemen, please extend a warm welcome this morning to Mr. Danna Kammersgard.
Thank you. I really appreciate the invitation to be here. I'm very excited to speak to you today. I want to address, I think it was the third to the last question first, if I may, and that is, and you should ask this question of all the speakers that come from America at minimum, what do we think about the policies or at least the bombast that is coming out of Washington these days and how it affects the global economy? I would advise that if you're going to spend time watching American politics and American news media, that you think about it from an entertainment value predominantly. And I've been told that it brings American politics closer to the norm for other countries. That may or may not be the case, but policies are made, policies are made at industry levels and less so, and by the public, and less so by wild and crazy American presidents. So, a question for you. Recently in the news, there was announcement of a launch of nanosatellites. I think the number was a 104, which represents the largest number of satellites ever launched simultaneously. Anybody have any idea what country that was? For those of you who don't know, it was India. And that is a remarkable accomplishment, something that you should be very proud of. And it speaks to the intellectual capital and the capability that India has. And I tend to be controversial at times, at least that's what I've been told. If you think about the way that China has approached emerging into the digital age and India has approached emerging into the digital age, as Dr. Gowda said earlier, China is a very large manufacturing site, right? I'll tell you that the manufacturing part of the process is easy compared to the intellectual property development and the development of product and designs. The fact that you can launch 104 nanosatellites into orbit around the Earth gives some idea of just how capable this country is from an intellectual property, a design services point of view, whether it be hardware, software, the logistics of launching these satellites, et cetera. So, yes, we can manufacture here, and we need to manufacture here because it provides balance to the labor force. But you've solved the harder problem, which is building product, designing product, doing software, doing electronic design. All of those skills and all of those resources can be leveraged into the development of the manufacturing capability here in India as well. Seagate manufactures about 40 million disk drives per quarter, plus or minus. And we manufacture in China. We manufacture in Mexico. We manufacture in Korat. We don't manufacture here yet, but it certainly could be warranted. And the ability to put a factory in place is far simpler than the ability to put satellites in orbit and to develop and design the technology necessary to support that. I think that's worth keeping in mind. So I want to talk about the same thing you've heard quite a bit about over the last couple of days. You can call it the Internet of Things. We happen to call it something slightly different, but it's the same thing. And it's driving the growth of data. It's driving the explosion of data. And that creates opportunity here as well. Why? Question was asked about, or a comment was made, I think it was by Dr. Gowda, with respect to anti-globalization, right? Anti-globalization creates a tremendous opportunity here in India and everywhere. And it's less about Trump or Brexit or other politics. It has a lot more to do with the protection of data. So we start to see countries say that my people's personal data cannot leave country boundaries. Why is that? Well, they're concerned about the privacy of the data. They're concerned about identity theft. They're concerned about cybersecurity. And so all of a sudden, you've got to put cloud data centers in each country as opposed to exporting that data across boundaries. Very reasonable thing. That's creating trends that result in perhaps a little bit of anti-globalization, and that creates the opportunity for India to stand up your own data centers, set up your own manufacturing. It's this data growth, I think, that's driving that trend more than anybody's politics. So just a few statistics as background. In the year 2000, there was a grand total of 3 exabytes worth of data in the connected space. By the year 2025, we will grow that by 3 orders of magnitude. And when you put 104 satellites into the air simultaneously, there's going to be an awful lot of data streaming that comes from that, data creation that comes from that, necessary data collection that goes with that, and ultimately the analytics associated with it. Another set of statistics, the Internet of Things and its affiliated segments will create 600,000 exabytes. Think about that. Seagate shipped about 68 exabytes of storage last quarter. The amount of data that is now being collected or soon will be collected is almost overwhelming. It represents tremendous opportunity for all of us. Has to be analyzed, has to be stored, has to be managed. We stopped talking about time to collect or time to archive. We start talking about time to predict, time to preempt in some cases. And as we look forward into the future, there's a great deal of opportunity here to capitalize on that. One of the nice things about being late to market is you get to learn from the pioneers. The countries that didn't deploy a lot of landlines were first to adopt smartphones and wireless technologies. The countries that may be late to market from a manufacturing point of view can learn from those that went before and take advantage of advanced technologies that are available today. So I don't think in any regard that we don't have a tremendous opportunity here with respect to instituting manufacturing capability in country. We do. The challenge is to take the resources that are available here and apply them in that direction. Niranjan, you asked a question earlier. What was it? Yeah, so the question was, how do we foster local manufacturing support, right? Well, how did we foster local design capability, local electronics capability? It was by learning from others. So I would say invite Foxconn in. Let them teach the local population how to manufacture. Learn from the best. And then you'll see the growth of local manufacturing infrastructure as well. So the data locality is changing. Back in the good old days, it was PCs and enterprise systems. Today, it's video gaming systems, it's virtual reality, it's cameras, it's drones. Soon it will be autonomous self-driving cars. And in that context, given that the data origin is changing, from a systems point of view, a storage systems point of view, the technology has to change with it. And that technology is today represented with all flash, software defined, hyperconverged, and other buzzwords that we in the industry tend to invent to confuse people, especially end users. All of this results in the need to change the strategy as well. Okay, from our point of view, we have to move in the direction of Internet of Things. We have to move in the direction of the cloud, where the growth is now occurring. One of the phenomena that is occurring in the cloud is this notion of the compression of the supply chain. So IBM talked about moving up into cognitive learning and Watson, right? We all are moving up the value chain. You can think of that from a country point of view. You can think about that from a company point of view as well. Everybody is moving in the direction of increased total available market, expanded gross margins, growth as far as revenues go. Meanwhile, the cloud infrastructure, which is fairly embryonic here in India, but is growing, and that will force more trends towards in-country development, whether it be in-country data capture and retention or in-country manufacturing and design, is moving down the supply chain. So the companies that used to sell to the resellers, the VARs, the distributors, the OEMs that used to sell to these companies, Alibaba, Baidu, Amazon, etc., are now being squeezed out of the supply chain. And they're beginning to work with original component manufacturers who have real intellectual property value that can move the needle either in terms of cost of goods or total cost of ownership. We expect that will happen here as well. Today, Seagate is working with a number of hyperscalers directly inventing for them, whether it be all flash arrays, whether it be so-called super drives, whether it be very high dense system storage. And the reason is because we have the intellectual property necessary to do that. A lot of that IP is in fact created here in India in our locations in Pune and Bangalore. That's hardware, that's software, that's mechanical, that's electrical. And we'll see some of that here in just a minute. So Seagate talks more in terms of streaming big data than IoT. And IoT is a subset of what we call streaming big data. And there's a significant architectural difference between how storage systems are architected for this kind of application as opposed to a traditional transaction-oriented Oracle database. Okay, the 104 satellites that you put up into orbit are going to create large streams of data that have to be captured somewhere on Earth. Okay, so instead of having a normal random I/O, half reads, half writes, what happens here is you have 100% write application. And so it's a different architecture from a systems point of view. It's even a different architecture potentially from a device point of view. That's what the IoT is. That's what autonomous self-driving cars create. That's what satellite downlink is. That's what video surveillance is. And as we evolve that in the direction of smart cities, which may be, you know, the near-term nirvana as far as the digital age goes, you're going to see a radically different requirement in terms of data capture, data management, data analytics, data archive, data retention. I think this is an area where India can be at the forefront, and certainly our development team in India is leading the charge for Seagate's cloud systems business. So what does that mean? You know, if we look at it in its ultimate situation, we could take the city of Bangalore as an example. 10 years from now, I hope there are no self-driving cars here, by the way, but 10 years from now, we will have automated traffic management systems. We will have automated hospital management systems. We will have homes connected to the internet with hundreds of devices per residence. We certainly have on the very near horizon autonomous self-driving cars. Connected cars, connected transportation, connected traffic management, connected medical facilities, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. This is what's going to drive the 600,000 exabytes of data creation in the next few years. We have to be ready for that from a storage point of view, because that's the business that we're in. We have to be ready for it from a development, design, and manufacturing point of view as well. So Seagate, as you know, perhaps, I would hope, is best known as a device company. And in that context, we put 2 billion hard disk drives into the market. My business is running Seagate systems. My business is pulling Seagate up the value chain into storage systems and storage platforms. We're doing a lot of that development. We're putting a major investment here in India in that regard. And in this context, we've got to be ready for the next generation, if you will, of the digital age, whether it's digital age 2.0 or digital age 4.0. This notion of a connected environment, a connected ecosystem, is what we have to support. We do that with some very innovative development, much of which, as I indicated, is happening here. And by owning both sets of intellectual property, the intellectual property at the device level, the intellectual property at the system level, we can create intelligent disk drives, intelligent storage systems that can do much of the analysis that is required to support these massive streams of ingest simultaneously. We can do this in very dense systems. And as we collect more and more data, we're going to find that the density required is dramatically increasing. So we talk in terms of a petabyte drive these days. Today's current standard for an individual spindle is 10 terabytes, 12 terabytes. But we've got to think much bigger than that, and we're starting to talk in terms of a petabyte device. Doesn't matter if it's flash, doesn't matter if it's disk, doesn't matter if it's a hybrid, right? It has the intelligence to heal itself, it has the intelligence to manage itself. You can think of it almost as a hermetically sealed black box. But inside the black box, not only do we have the ability to handle tens, if not hundreds of thousands of streams, but we have the ability to do the analytics associated with determining what is important about those streams, time to insight, time to predict, time to preempt as well. Same thing goes in the flash space, all flash arrays with hyper-density and hyper-performance to accommodate these thousands upon thousands of streams that are coming in the near future. So from a footprint point of view, we're proud to be here. We have facilities in Pune as well as in Bangalore. We design hardware. We design silicon. We design solid-state devices. We design mechanics, and we design software and firmware here. If you think classically, India has been known for software services. The question in the earlier conversation had to do with data as a service, and the answer is absolutely. If there's an area to invest in, it's the data analytics and data as a service. You know, to me, there's a tremendous opportunity there. You have the intellectual capital, you have the experience, you have the expertise. The digital world is evolving. We're moving into the connected world, for lack of a better term, and being able to provide that insight, that intelligence, that information that yields faster time to decision, faster time to predict, faster time to preempt in some cases, that becomes very, very important. And I think that's where we're investing with respect to our teams in India in terms of the infrastructure necessary to support that new digital or connected age. So with that, let me stop and take some questions. Get us back on time a little bit. Any questions? I'm sorry?
What will make Seagate look at India for manufacturing?
So the question was, what would it take for Seagate to consider putting manufacturing here? From a systems point of view, it's relatively easy. And I think what you'll see in general is a trend towards designed in country, made in country. Maybe that started with the US and the federal government. Maybe it has been evolved with respect to China and the need to design in China, make in China. The same is happening in Korea. The same is happening in Germany. And I think a lot of it has to do with the integrity of data and the cybersecurity phenomenon and risks that I mentioned earlier. From a systems point of view, we can stand up a manufacturing line relatively straightforward here with an EMS of choice, whether that be a local EMS or whether that be a global EMS. And that could be done in a year, right? From my point of view, not a lot of investment, not a lot of time. It really is going to be determined on the basis of where the government decides to create this preferential treatment. In other words, if designed in India, which we do today, is insufficient to be able to capture Indian federal government opportunity, then manufactured in India or made in India becomes a requirement. It doesn't take much more than that. You have one of the largest populations in the world, obviously. You have one of the deepest intellectual capital resource pools in the world. There's great growth here. Growth rate in India is faster than China today. And so you will see the same kind of migration into the market that we saw in China, with perhaps fewer obstacles, for a variety of good reasons. To take our high volume products and manufacture in India, in other words, you know, some portion of the 40 million disk drives that we make every quarter, that's gonna be based on demand more than anything. And then subsequently, any government regulation or any government preference for manufacturing in India. That manufacturing is a little bit more involved because it does require clean room facilities. The manufacturing for my business, where we produce perhaps 100,000 systems a year, can be set up very straightforwardly. And I would look forward to the opportunity to do that.
With all this expanding data, we keep hearing that there is a tremendous power consumption that's happening. You know, like we may have to build more and more power plants just to power this additional storage devices, right? So across the system, what is happening to sort of bring down the power that the world has to produce to store all this data?
Yeah, that's a great question. So if we extrapolate the requirements for power on the basis of the amount of storage required for the data, it becomes a very large number very quickly. And in fact, total cost of ownership becomes an overriding criteria or an overriding contributor to the cost of goods, even more so than the components that go in. And there's a lot of things that we're working on with respect to power management. All of it has to do fundamentally with intelligent firmware. For example, we can predict when a device is going to be accessed based on historical precedent. There's no reason for us to keep that device spinning or to keep that device up, you know, in the case of a solid state, if we don't anticipate that it's going to be accessed in the next second or two. So you'll see a lot more intelligence embedded into not only the device, but the storage system for managing power. We can run them slower if they're not being accessed. We can stop them entirely if they're not being accessed and get much more intelligent about how we manage power in the process.
One quick question. Hi. So quick question. You talked about a lot about analytics of the data, right? And vision analytics is one of the, you know, areas that has seen a lot of improvement, AI-based vision analytics over the past couple of years. So what is your thought on that? Are you putting these analytics piece in the Seagate systems domain, or would you rather kind of get it done by the Googles and the Facebooks of the world?
Yeah, that's a great question, and the answer is yes. In other words, yes, the analytics need to be done at the device level, and yes, the analytics need to be done at the data center level. So if you think of the classic architecture on how the internet was founded, when companies like Inctomy and Cashflow were in existence, we had origin devices, we had edge devices, and then we had the data center, right? If we use your satellites as an example, that's an origin device. They're beaming down, you know, to perhaps edge devices that ultimately transmit the data to the data center, right? Video surveillance, the same thing. An individual camera has a solid state device in it or a disk device in it, etc. And in that context, it collects the data locally. A neighborhood or a community or a school district or hospital of cameras may collect the data and aggregate it to an edge appliance. And then a whole school district or a set of regional hospitals or a city's video surveillance cameras may go back to a data center. So if we talk about time to insight, time to decision, time to predict, time to preempt, the closer to the data that the analytics is performed accelerates that time to insight. So there are analytics that can be produced right at the camera level, right? It's not that difficult. It's real-time, frame-by-frame pattern recognition. But that same insight gets closer to that same analytics get closer to insight at the edge level, where now you're looking at perhaps a community of cameras, a neighborhood of cameras, or whatever. You don't have to wait until it gets back to the data center to get the insight. The insight needs to occur, the analytics need to be embedded in each of those tiers to get the time to insight. And the other aspect of that is 99% of the data collected is irrelevant, because 99% of the data doesn't change anything. So in this particular example, you're looking at patterns or differentials in patterns. And so the faster that you can throw away data that's irrelevant and pass on data that's relevant, not only are you going to get to time to insight faster, but you're also going to have to collect less data, you know, in the data center at the end of the day. So I think we should be doing it at the device level. I think we should be doing it at the storage systems level. And yes, it needs to be done in the data center, whether or not that's cloud-based or not. Today's cloud isn't really well architected for this kind of application. Last week you put 100 satellites in the air. Next year you'll put 1,000. The year after that you may put 100,000 cameras. Okay, that's all streaming data back to a storage collection device. The cloud latency really doesn't support that massive ingest of real-time data. And if we're talking about 1080i resolution of images, that's one thing. If we're talking about 4K high-res stereoscopic images, that's another thing. And if we're talking about 8K ultra-high def at 60 frames a second as opposed to 24 frames per second, that's an entirely different thing. So public cloud is not necessarily well suited for this environment. But it gets back to the question that was asked earlier, is data as a service or is data analytics as a service a new frontier for the human and intellectual capital that's represented in this room in this country? Absolutely. My recommendation though would be to productize that as opposed to sell it as a service. You can productize the service in the product. The problem with design as a service, as has historically been done here, is that you end up selling off the intellectual property, or you give away the intellectual property with the NRE that comes. And at the end of the day, it's the ownership of the intellectual property that's going to make the difference, my view. Does he have a microphone?
I'm Vijay Agarwal. I'm interested in wearable devices. My question is about ownership of data. Does the consumer own it? Does the companies own it? Do the government own it? Or do the companies own it? And is there going to be, like, can we say in future, what could be the emerging convergence in terms of ownership rights as far as worldwide regulation is concerned? And could we have a situation wherein the data analytics companies could have to pay for right to use of my personal data? Because it looks like right now it's like, okay, the data is almost free and if we can analyze it, we can make a lot of money. But could we see that consumers coming together in future and like what you said about anti-globalization, each country is going to have a cloud. Could we say that the consumers in future could say that my personal data could only reside with me on a wearable device on my body and I will only allow access of use, but I have complete ownership and I should be paid each time you use my data?
That's an excellent question. One thing we know, and there is no crystal answer today, if I knew the answer to that one definitively, I'd be paid a lot of money. One thing we know is that government is asserting itself with the ability to regulate the location of data, right? This is the notion of data with borders. The country of Germany will not allow personal data collected from my population to cross my border. They're not asserting ownership of the data, but they are asserting the authority to regulate where the data resides. If you take a picture of me in a certain context, in theory, you're not allowed to use that picture of me without my prior consent, at least in the US, right? So there's a form of data that clearly, at least the authorization to use is to be granted by the person whose picture was taken. The search firm companies, as was earlier noted, have made a whole lot of money by using data that they don't own and then selling off that data. The notion of a search firm in business to be a search firm is pretty naive. They're collecting data and then they're using that data with internal analytics and or selling that data to mass marketers, right? I happen to believe that at the end of the day, the individual owns his data just like an individual owns his medical file. Now, if you strip off the particulars about that individual and you make it anonymous and you aggregate it and you analyze it, I don't think the individual owns that data anymore. I think that the company that aggregated the data, stripping off any personal identification, and then aggregating and analyzing data owns the rights to that analysis. But it's a very, there's going to be an awful lot of interesting lawsuits and fights as we move into the next generation of the digital age in that context.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, that'll have to be the last question. I'd like to request all of you to please give Mr. Danner, Kammersgard, a huge round of applause. I'd like to request Mr. Niranjan Pol, Engineering Director, Seagate Technologies, and IESA Executive Council to present Mr. Danner with a small token of our appreciation.
Do I know you?
I'd like to thank you, sir, once again for that keynote address. The next keynote address.